So just to get straight onto it, before I start with the questions, I just wanted to go run quickly through your profile because I actually didn't realize it was so extensive from the Canadian viewpoint. I only knew from the Nasheed viewpoint, but apparently the folk and music that you did before that, and then the TV appearances, you made a couple more in on Canadian television than you have internationally, is that right? Awesome. So you're more of a recognized, would you say, in the Muslim and non-Muslim community, musician in Canada than you are abroad?
No, actually, no, I think probably still more abroad. I mean, the work that I've done in Canada has sort of been nameless, like there's some documentary work and that sort of thing, but mm-hmm. But yeah, I don't do a lot of other work or even performances and things here in Canada very much. Locally, I try to do a lot where I live.
Yeah.
But, I think generally in England and South Africa and Europe, is in the US,
okay.
Kind of know me there a bit more.
And with regards to it mentions you in folk circles, like when you started out, you were into Irish and Canadian folk, and
yeah.
Apparently some of your songs are still remembered in folk circles. So in that community, would you say you're well better recognized?
Maybe at that time, and now the songs are kind of, those adaptions of songs that I did at, I'm talking 20 years ago or something.
Yeah, 93.
They're still circulating, but not necessarily. People don't really care about me. It's more the songs.
So,
yeah.
It was the lyrics that resonated? That's why it stuck around, did you say?
No, I think it was the quirkiness. There's an old Irish song called Black Velvet Band.
Yeah, you made a comedy version of it.
Yeah, I made a twist on that. So I think it's just kind of the novelty of what I did to the songs that kind of carried on maybe a little bit more.
Okay.
There's definitely a lot of local musicians here who know me and that I've worked with,
yeah.
But I'm not really in those commercial circles very much either. Like,
yeah.
I'm involved with the Canadian Society of Composers and that sort of thing,
mm-hmm.
But my work doesn't tend to be on the same musical circuit as
right.
as a lot of those performers, so in that way we kind of cross paths, but we're not really directly
in the same direction.
Yeah, a good friend of mine produced most of my Nishi sort of recordings.
Yeah.
He's a prominent composer here in Canada. Another high school friend is another one of the top composers for film and television in
yeah.
Canada. But we don't really do a lot of work together
yeah.
anymore. Also, think, you know.
Would you say that's how you started off your contracts, though, with personal contacts like that?
Not really, because we were all kind of the same age. We were all getting started at the same time.
Oh, yes.
So, Rob Carley, who's a prominent composer for television in Canada,
yeah.
He and I were in play
oh yeah, I read about that as well.
Pygmalion or whatever, what's that, My Fair Lady, you know, we would see her. He was in a local rock band. Another artist, Danny Michelle, he was in a local rock band. I was in a local folk band. So we kind of started off crossing paths in the same way, but when I embraced the Quran, that kind of took me
mm-hmm.
one direction, and then they just kind of kept going with that other direction. So we all kind of know each other,
yeah.
But locally I'd say they're the degree of local sort of celebrity, if you will.
Yeah. No. Okay. Well, let's go on we'll come to that point about being mainstream and not soon, inshallah. I'm guessing you went over the questions. But
I did, absolutely. I try not to imprison myself too much by coming up with formulated answers.
Sure thing.
Your questions are really good, so I want to actually kind of write a few lines for each one so that I won't strip from the topic.
That's really kind of you. Thank you.
How do you want my answers to be in terms of editing and the time frame of the interview? Do you want me to keep it pretty concise? Or?
I just want to make sure that I respect your time. I said 20 minutes and that's all really. Other than that, it's completely the ball's in your court.
Okay.
So, with regards to the first question, would you describe yourself as an artist? And more recently, you started saying minstrel a little bit. Or would you call yourself a musician?
You know, when I enter a country and they ask me on the land card what my job is, I say musician just because it's easier
uh-huh.
than giving them a philosophical explanation. But I would definitely say a bit of both. I'm an artist I'm an activist who uses art as a primary means to promote social change. So,
okay.
Which came first, chicken or the egg? I think I'm more of an activist who
yeah.
just uses art as a means to try to achieve something in his own life and hopefully in the lives of other.
Okay, so I guess that answers the second question. What is the primary role of the artist in today's society? Is that what you'd say, to use it as a means for bigger things?
Well, I think it depends on the individual, maybe. Some art is very self-serving. Some art is very commercially focused. Some is motivational. Some is spiritual. Some is escapist. Some is very meditative. Some art is very culturally defining. And some is more a purpose of beautification, I think, of the mundane or the functional. And some art is very cathartic as well. So it has many different roles. And depending on how the artist chooses to use their expression, for me, I always sort of put the moniker onto all my emails, is that for me, it's about trying to better the world one song at a time.
Yeah.
So trying to use music to better the world one song at a time. And I'd like to think that my music has different dimensions to it. I definitely stray away from the commercial and the self-serving, but definitely I try to use it to motivate myself, to be meditative, and as well, if it can be culturally defining for some people, if it can be the purpose of beautification, especially to those things in our lives which are very mundane, then I'm happy for that.
Awesome. I mean, the theme for the series that we're doing and the artists we're interviewing in particular is freedom artists, artists that are after their own freedom as a creative, being a free to express themselves creatively, as well as freeing other people from, you know, the shackles of conforming to what they're told to do rather than what they innately want to do. So would you say that that's what you know, pursuing freedom in a sense is what your purpose is? And as an activist?
I mean, that word didn't come to mind, but since you say it, and when I look back in my life and how writing and cartooning and filmmaking and music have all been parts of my life at various times. When I was 13, I was really into filmmaking. When I was 10, I was into cartooning. And when I was, you know, between there somewhere, I was really into comedy, and I loved film and film comedy. Maybe one day I'll be a comedian. So, but then music kind of took over. Theater at different times, so, and it was always about trying to, there was an element of liberation to it, and to try to give other people the opportunity to liberate themselves as well through the art. So, yeah, I wouldn't have that word consciously come to my mind, but I can definitely see that. Appreciate that.
Okay. So you have your tea next to you, so please feel free to drink as much as you like.
And it's funny because it's a big breakfast tea, which I bought in, my sister brought me from England probably 25 years ago.
Awesome. Do you have cereal in it like I do? Because that's what I just did. But the other interesting thing to know, because you've moved genres so much, is who would be your influences? Like who? Because a lot of times people model their persona, their public image, on a personality that they've already seen. Like, I want to be like that guy, or I like this work, and I want to be like that. I want to emulate that kind of work. Who, from your early ages and moving onwards, have you always emulated, or have it shifted?
Well, obviously there's been, you know, a lot of inspiration in my life from many different artists and musicians, and that all kind of creeps into your work. You know, when I was listening to a lot of Jane Siberry, you know, when I was a younger person, who's a Canadian artist here, you know, that sort of improvisation style, dancing, found Jackson Brown, some of the artists, but I think really some of the key figures and how I've patterned myself as a musician are people like Pete Seeger, Harry Chapin, Phil Oakes. There's three examples of songwriters and activists. They were songwriters and activists, and the lines were so blurred you didn't quite know which one dominated. But the way that they lived as people, and the way they took what they learned from life and wove that into the music for the sake of other people really inspired me. The first album I ever received when I was 5 years old was a Pete Seeger album. And he was singing songs, you know, like There Was an Old Lady Who Swallowed a Fly, right next to songs about Martin Luther King and the environment, and cleaning up the environment. So as a 5 year old, those were the types of songs that first songs that I was hearing. My mother was letting me hear songs by John Denver, you know, and here he would be reciting poetry about war on his albums, and how war, you know, takes out children and destroys their lives. So as a young child, these were the things that I was being fed. And I think as I began to play music publicly and to look at what, you know, when you have a stage and people, you've got 50, 60, 100, 500 people in front of you who are giving you their time and they're listening to you. Have to say something, you know, and that was kind of the influences from those other artists, like Pete Seeger, Harry Chapin. Harry Chapin is an artist who had a philosophy that he'd do one show for himself and one show for the other guy. Mm-hmm. So where some artists would do 75 shows a year, he'd do 150, and half of those shows would all be free, you know, for the sake of charities and so on. So those are some of the models, I think, that really shaped who I am as a musician and as an actor. So.
Okay. And would you consider those people as your mentors, or is there somebody that you've been even closer to who you would say, yeah, that was a mentor, these were inspirations?
I would definitely, mentor, I can't say, maybe the word mentor doesn't work quite well for them, because I only had the opportunity to meet of those three, you know, Phil Oakes, Harry Chapin. Phil Oakes passed away in the 70s, and Harry Chapin passed away in the 80s. Pete Seeger is the only one that I ever met briefly, but I would definitely, Pete Seeger is mentor.
Okay, brilliant. And would you, because those aren't, obviously they're coming from folk and Canadian influences, but when you came into your nasheed genre, would you still hold them as well as your inspirations, or did you ever go to a point where you went, where you took somebody else, or they were consistent?
I think specifically Pete Seeger and Harry Chapin were mentors, have been mentors through my life, and right through into the work that I do, even that I've produced for the Muslim community, but ideologically there's been a lot of other very strong influences in my work, you know, from an ideological perspective. I'd say people like Henry David Thoreau, mm-hmm. and Helen Keller, yeah. Ralph Waldo Emerson, René Guignol, Francis Schoen, and Martin Lings. These are people whose ideologies I've always connected with, you know, since I was a young man.
Mm-hmm. Okay, great. And
someone like Yusuf Islam as well, obviously. I mean, I grew up listening to music with Cat Stevens, so when I became a Muslim and had the opportunity to meet Yusuf Islam,
that would have been really exciting.
Before I became a Muslim, I met Yusuf.
Yeah.
And I think obviously his work and his songs from the 70s were a great, great inspiration to me in terms of my guitar playing and my songwriting. Mm-hmm. He's been a wonderful influence.
And why did you make that decision then to move into the nasheed genre, and how did you string it from what you did before? Because that was a huge leap in market. You'd say that the people you were playing to before just weren't there in the other market, or vice versa.
Yeah, well, it's amazing how life twists and turns. For me, as I say, you know, I've always looked at myself as more of an activist mm-hmm. than a musician. So when I started playing music at the age of about 17, it was much more about, you know, I always tell people the reason I write songs is because I can't afford a therapist. Writing music helped me, you know, work out some of the things in life that most of us, you know, as teenagers go through.
Yeah.
And when I started playing publicly, I thought it was, you know, it was in an effort to kind of connect with other people who I thought might feel the same way as me.
Mm-hmm.
But the environments I was in, the bars and the pubs and all that, folk festivals, people were gracious and they would applaud and they didn't throw tomatoes at me, but I could tell the disconnect. You know, people didn't quite get it, and it filled me with a lot of anxiety. One time, a friend of mine who used to help me with my performances, he said, "You know, the problem, Dave, is that nobody wants to hear you sing in your journal."
Yes.
So that's kind of why I turned to busking, was because I felt as if my music was part of my journey of life, and I didn't feel comfortable trying to compete with other artists. You know, he's doing that. Well, now I've got to try to learn that. Or he's writing about this, man. I got to up my game now.
Mm-hmm.
It was kind of that game of trying to compete, and then trying to sell it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that felt strange to me as well. Yeah. You're trying to make music and then sell it to people and convince them that they need to buy my album. And, mm-hmm. and that was always a little strange. So I was quite happy to back away from all that.
Yeah.
And that's where I would say someone like Cat Stevens, Yusuf Islam, was an inspiration, because I met him in those days. And at that time when I met him, that's what I found most inspirational about him, is that he had walked away at that time
mm-hmm.
from that commercial life, and I found that great, greatly motivational and inspirational. So when I, you know, took a time away, that's when I noticed that most of the children I was meeting in those days, were their approach to faith was being taught to them very dogmatically and very heartless way.
Mm-hmm.
And when I learned of the traditional machine,
mm-hmm.
I thought, well, let me now take my musical experience and put it into writing some songs for children, because I thought, here's a community of people, which I had put akin to the Mennonite community, the Muslim community, I thought was very, very conscientious, very God-conscious, and very, very strong in their application of faith.
Mm-hmm.
And like the Mennonite community that I grew up with here in Ontario, some shun modern trappings of technology and faith. I thought, well, here's a community of people who are very God-focused and God-centered. There's no way they would ever dream of commercializing.
Little did you know.
Little did I know. So when I wrote this song to put them out, I said, if any money comes back, I'll put it in charity.
Yeah.
And I'm not going to put my face on the album cover. I'm not going to make videos. I'm not going to do performances. I'm just going to
put
it
out. Oh, so that was all your decision?
Those were my decisions.
Right, okay.
And within 5 years, there were companies springing up all over the world. And videos. And suddenly all these machine artists were wearing beaded necklaces. And I looked around, what is happening? And it's actually a sadness.
Yeah.
I never dreamt that and Yusuf, Sam, and Zain, Bhikha, and I went sat together and talked about how we all felt like Dr. Frankenstein. Here we were doing what we were doing, this for the sake of something, for the sake of children, really.
Yeah.
And we had no idea we were kind of turning into what we were turning into. So, it took a few years to kind of.
Okay. Well, we're coming up to, it's such a fascinating discussion. We're coming up to 20 minutes. I don't know how you're doing for time.
I'm totally fine if you want to keep going and then hack it down.
Yeah, it's. Thank you. I'm absolutely fascinated by what you're telling me. But I really, because Zain Bhikha, for example, is someone who did eventually, like recently, with his son, he's come out with his own studio. He's far more commercialized, you'd argue, than you are. He's done renditions of very famous songs that have put him into a larger market. And, you know, the high-definition videos. So, which is great, because that's his thing. But all I'm interested to know is how you're very famously non-commercial, and you know you stayed away from mainstream. So and you even have a blog, Simple Living. So is that because of your, again, you were saying the community that you grew up with in Ontario and your influences as an early musician? That's what you put it down to, your philosophy.
Yeah, my philosophy, and it's very much a personal thing. Zain and I worked together at a time. I appear in some of his high-definition videos. And,
me too.
But, you know, and Yusuf as well, that was, of course, a very artistic and very commercial road. I remember when I did one of my albums, and I was getting some advice from Yusuf on it, and I said, what do you think? And he's like, the music's okay, but you need to come up with an image.
Yeah.
And it's different. It's different for different artists. It depends on the That was advice I didn't take.
Yeah.
Because if anything, the guy who struggles with ego as I do, the last thing I need is to come up with some PR kit that I start to believe, about myself. So I intentionally shoot myself in the foot a lot so that I try to remain grounded.
Okay.
And definitely the approach that I take to work is to try to keep me from losing my philosophy.
Yeah.
Which, as I say, people like Henry David Thoreau or even people like the 7th century Prophet Muhammad, when I look at the things that were taught through history, and scripturally, if I give you this example, the Quran talks about astronomy, it talks about agriculture, it talks about healing, it talks about how to get along in society and how to defend oneself, it talks about spirituality and faith, but there's no chapter called the farmers, there's no chapter called the doctors, there's no chapter called the scientists, the politicians, there's no chapter called the imams, or the jurists, but there is a chapter called the poets.
Yeah.
And poets, it warns, it cautions the poets that there are those who wander around distracted in the world and they practice, and they say what they don't practice. And if people follow them, they are misled.
Yeah.
And it's not saying we can't be poets, but it's saying if you're going to be a poet, there's a difference between what is poetic recitation and what is divine recitation.
Yeah.
And you have to be careful that you don't begin to think that your poetry is all that, and that you are going to start to live critically.
Yeah.
So I take that verse very seriously, and that philosophy of my approach to my poetry and my work is so important for me to protect at all costs. And people like Zain, people like Yusuf, I think maybe they're much more balanced than I am, that they're able to balance the commercial, people like Richard Thompson.
Mm-hmm.
These are people who follow in a very similar line as I do, but they're able to maneuver in the mainstream. I don't know if I could. I think I would probably lose myself.
Yep.
At the risk of that, I tried to just keep it really simple.
Okay. Well, yeah, that's a beautiful a verse, actually, that I heard a very strong tafsir on, which likens it to why art is so important, why art is, and why ignoring art is actually to our detriment as a community. So it's really good that you brought that up. But it's fascinating because, you know, you went through the struggle in, say, what, 80s, 90s, and even now I have friends who are musicians and going through exactly the same thing as you went through in that time now. And, you know, they're getting offered contracts by Sony and getting told to come up with images, but they're shunning it and wanting to stay in the busking level of things. So for them, it'll be really interesting to hear that somebody's gone through that journey before them as well.
You know, and by saying that, I'm not saying it's wrong. It's wrong for me. But, you know, a good friend of mine is a young fellow in America, Rife, is his name.
Yep.
I know before Rife signed his contract with kind of a record label, we had months of discussions of that move. And now Rife, you know, has been able to enter into a commercial contract, but maintain a lot of who he is. And I think was able to secure, you know, an environment around himself in that commercial environment, which protects him and his family and his personality. Mm-hmm. And that's wonderful. And if maybe, I think sometimes by me taking the approach I've taken, it can at least show other artists what to be cautious of. Yeah. Another great influence for me is Prince, actually. Singer Prince.
Mm-hmm.
I grew up loving his music, and more than just his music, which is phenomenal. His approach to real self-subsisting approach to music and production, you know, and the mistakes that he made signing with Warner Music, yeah, it gave him his fame, but it also, you know, bound him for years to contracts that he couldn't get out of. And seeing that, like, you know what, I would never let that happen to me, but he came out of it, and, you know, having his own studio, his own company, securing owning all his own publishing rights, these are things that, as an artist, Charlie Chaplin was one of my previous inspirations as well, because he did that within the film industry.
Mm-hmm.
He was a composer, he was a filmmaker, director, actor, and he did it all himself. And I think there's something really special about having a studio and being master of that domain where no one can take your voice away from you.
Well, that comes to, again, on the theme of freedom. I mean, financial freedom is, of course, a huge part of, like, if you could live abundantly off your work, would you have produced all the work that you have produced, or would you say some of it was because of, you know, you wanted to go in the direction where you could then have your own and then do your own thing?
Yeah, it's definitely made my work very personal to me, because there has been a few times when I have had worked with companies that have financially backed my work.
Mm-hmm.
And to this day, I don't own those products. It doesn't hurt so much because the organization is also a non-profit and they do a lot of education, so I don't feel bad about the fact that, you know, I administrate my recordings, but every month I pay that company basically 90% of the money.
Wow.
So money comes in from my songs and I write a check again.
Yeah, that's crazy.
It goes to charity, so it's not hard to part. But it is a little weird as a songwriter.
Yeah.
And if I had had that financial abundance, I might not have been able to produce as much. The other aspect is that my work remains close to me because I know I have to work very hard for it.
Yeah.
I have a personal policy against now taking financial assistance from my record. So I don't engage in crowdsource funding. I don't take money from executive producers or anything. So it means my albums don't come out every year now. They might come out every 3 or 4 years.
Mm-hmm.
I save up that money, I make the album, and that's how it goes. And so I know that it's a labor of love.
Mm-hmm.
I know that my family cuts corners at home and lives simply.
Mm-hmm.
So to make the music, and that means that there's a bit of my family in some ways too, you know.
Yeah.
So it makes it very special for me.
Mm-hmm. And would you say that if you were able to live abundantly from your art, it would be less special then? Or would it be, if it wasn't as much of a labor to get it going off the ground?
If I had an abundance of wealth to help me, would I make the big videos and all that? I don't think so. One thing I would love to do if I had a bit more in the well, I would love to be able to tour regularly with a group of backing musicians. I think that would make the music more enjoyable for the audiences.
Yeah.
To be able to see a bit more of a performance of musicianship on stage.
Yeah.
I have toured in the past with artists and...
Yeah, Fletcher Valve, we remember that a lot in London,
Idris Phillips.
Yeah.
But in those days, in order to make that happen, I had to live Pakistan, you know, or in Syria or in Egypt, you know, where my living expenses were literally cut in half or less than half.
Yeah.
And then I would use that extra money to pay these artists to come over. But now that I've resettled in Canada, that isn't an option.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, my family would be, you know, living on
nothing.
Rice and some water. So I have to keep it balanced.
Yeah,
but,
of course.
But at the end of the day, though, I think that I would also find it hard to justify the expense of using larger studios and session players all the time.
Yeah.
So really, I think for me, I just want to hone my craft of musicianship at home, and it's comfortable doing that without all the wealth. And it also gives me time to do other things. I'm interested in carpentry, gardening, beekeeping, cooking, sewing. So, you know, if I had more wealth, maybe I could engage more in those things.
Mm-hmm.
But right now, I'm keeping the balance pretty well. I'm pretty happy and content.
Well, it's inspiring to hear that, especially at a time when art is selling for more than it's ever sold in history. Like, from music all the way to fine art, it's at its highest price sales. I mean, in the 90s, people would buy famous artists like Roy Lichtenstein sign for $1,000 and sell it off again for $50,000. So artists again would lose out. But now, you know, people like Damien Hirst sell a head full of diamonds for for something like $63 million, and somebody sells it off again for another $100 million or whatever. So there's no same kind of, there's almost like a investment in property, the way you invest in art. And it's the same in the music world, Lady Gaga and all these artists. How do you feel about mainstream music like that?
Yeah, I mean, the mainstream music, especially how it's evolved in the last 2 years, to me, it's so out of control from how I see music that I'm not really very heavily engaged with it.
Yeah.
Because it's like seeing a film that's all been done on CG. When you go and you see it, you realize you're watching a cartoon, you know, it's all computer generated. So it's kind of the same when I listen to music now. I don't quite know what's legit anymore.
Yeah.
And I know that it's been backed so much by this machine.
Yeah.
It's hard to see through all that and look for the real talented artist.
Mm-hmm.
I'm really disconnected from the music business now, the music world, because of that imbalance of economics.
Yeah.
And again, going back to some of those inspirations, people like Henry David Thoreau, you know, my approach to life is very different when it comes to money. And I'm not a fan of money. I don't like money.
Mm-hmm.
I try to stay away from it. I told my daughters from the moment they were old enough to speak, you know, what do we do with money? Give it away! I just think it really messes up my mind. And again, also talking about people like Yusuf and Zain, I think the reason why people like Zain, Bhikha, and Yusuf is that have remained very dear to me as other Muslim, as fellow Muslim musicians, those two specifically, is because they are among sort of the machine world. We are among a group of very few of us who actually, you know, only do music in our lives. That's what people see, anyway. But on the backside, we have other lives. Yusuf Islam, for decades, has given away. His royalties, they go to the work that he's set up, the charities he's involved in, the schools he's involved in. So he's not interested in making money off the Muslim community or anybody else for the sake of money. And Zain as well. Zain Bhikha Studios is a part of the non-profit institute that his father runs in South Africa. So when Zain does these flashy videos and tours and albums, all that money's going back to that charity. My work as well, the money is going to the school in Pakistan that my family is involved with. So because we are in that realm, money doesn't mean anything to us.
Yep.
So it keeps us a little bit more focused on being able to just express whatever we want.
Yeah.
And rambling.
Not at all. That's a very interesting way of looking at it, because the way somebody like Damien Hirst, for example, justifies his position on money is he says it's not art for money, it's art made with money. So he's saying that I put all my money is for my art almost. But I mean, I don't know how far that goes, because again, he's very establishment. So, but how would you say that, because you know, the Muslims that are very conservative, they look at an image of you with a guitar, whatever, and they suddenly associate you with the mainstream music world, even though you're very far removed from it. So how do you think that the mainstream music world has impacted your position in music? Has it pushed you further away from it, or?
Our scene or whatever. So they might not be technically playing the guitar on stage, but the trappings of commercial capitalistic music business are surrounding them.
Yeah.
Completely. So I find that ironic and consistent.
Mm-hmm.
The message of what the Quran teaches. And so, not as a judgment, but just as an observation.
Okay.
So I would sooner get up on stage with my guitar and do it honestly and get there in an economy flight or drive in my own car and bunk in somebody's bathtub, you know, than to be putting these very commercial demands upon hosts and that sort of thing. It's hard to define it, but I think that there, it's not just what you see. Let me put it to you this way.
Mm-hmm.
Balance in our lives, we often think of balance as being in the middle.
Mm-hmm.
So if I take, for example, I've got this little pen here, it looks like a hammer.
Mm-hmm.
Our mind naturally thinks that balance is going to be in the middle. Right? So if I want to balance this and I put my finger in the middle, it's going to fall.
Mm-hmm.
Because balance isn't always in the middle. Balance, you have to take into consideration the environment, and you have to take into consideration the weight of that thing you're trying to balance. So for me to balance this pen on my finger, you know, I need to actually put my finger off center.
Yeah, that's very interesting.
It doesn't look like it would be balanced, but it's balanced.
Mm-hmm.
And I think sometimes in our lives, we think we're going to be balanced, and we're just going to be in the middle.
Yeah.
We're going to be off balance. And so for me, I would sooner, to everybody else, they might look at me and say, this guy's not balanced. He's not in the middle. But I am actually balanced because I know how things should be distributed in my own life to keep focused in my heart and in my work.
Yeah.
And economically, if somebody offers me a check for $50,000 or $150,000 and says, let's produce a video for you, most people would say, you're an idiot. Why would you take the money? It's an old Arab proverb that says, you know, when the king puts the poet on the payroll, he cuts off the tongue of the poet.
Mm-hmm.
So for me, I would say, no, thank you for the money. And they'd say, you're imbalanced.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I might look imbalanced, but I know in my heart there's balance.
Okay.
There. So,
brilliant.